Good afternoon. My name's Calvin Montague, and I want to welcome you to this week's Integrated Crop Protection and Soil Wealth webinar. This week we're having a seminar brought to you by Andy Ryland on, what is it again, Andy?
Managing insect pests in glasshouses, an IPM approach.
Thanks for that, Andy. I guess I just want to run through a couple of things before I pass it over to Andy for the presentation. The first one is questions. Can you just move it on to the next slide? We encourage you to ask questions during the webinar. I will read those out or present them to Andy, and we'll have more of a discussion. So the more questions we get from you guys, the better. The screen that you can see now is how you ask questions. So on the right-hand side of your panel, you'll see there should be a questions tab there. And if you click on that and then just type your questions into the box, and then I'll see them through here, and I'll aim to aggregate those up and ask them to Andy during the webinar. And again, I'll just reinforce, if you can ask those questions early, that works better that way, and then we can break it up, the webinar, and have it more of a discussion as we're going through. The other thing I'd just like to say is that we will again be recording the webinar, and it will be made available on the Integrated Crop Protection and Soil Wealth website, and you'll get an email out notifying when that'll be done, and that's probably by this afternoon or tomorrow that'll be available. So please share it around to your colleagues. I think that's pretty much all that I have to do, so I'll hand you over to Andy.
Thank you, Kelvin.
Glasshouses.
Okay. Thank you, Kelvin. Good afternoon, everyone. As our title suggests, we're going to be talking about insect pests in glasshouses, but with an IPM approach, we decided to select three key glasshouse vegetable pests to talk about in a little bit of detail in how you manage them in an integrated pest management program. And the reasons we've picked those is because they are critical pests that are causing more and more problems, mainly due to resistance to insecticides, which is making them very hard to manage. So taking an IPM approach is becoming more and more essential. And that involves not just using biological controls, but also using the environment to try and prevent pests getting in there in the first place and make the environment as unsuitable for pests as you possibly can. I've broken the presentation down into about just three main areas. And the first steps, I'm just going to talk about some of those physical and cultural practices to try and manage a crop and prevent pests from becoming a problem early on. Then I'm going to talk about monitoring and how critically important that is to good pest management anywhere. And then we'll follow up with IPM management decisions based around using biological control of these three key pests. This term, a stressed plant is more likely to be damaged by pests, is very true. Healthy plants can resist pest and disease attack. And managing the environment in the glasshouse is one way that you can help plants stay healthy and resist pest diseases. Environmental management often focuses on temperature and humidity management, and actual physical structures can have a difference, make a difference in how those environment issues are managed. The height of glass houses makes for better air movement. Higher houses with higher ridges have better air movement, keep cooler, and have lower humidities. Many insect pests prefer high temperatures and high humidities. Managing them in the glasshouse can make the crop less enticing for those pests. Multi-span glass houses tend to have better air movement than single span glass houses. And ridge venting also makes a huge difference to being able to manage both temperature and relative humidity. In the house...
I'll pause you there, Andy. So Andy, you are out with your IPM consulting business. You're out looking at insects frequently. When you go into a multi-span glass house, are you seeing less pest pressure than you do in a single-span glass house?
Definitely, yes. The air movement and the environment in the multi-span is generally so much better than small or single-span houses. It's so much easier to manage the environment that way. Yeah. Most new projects are installing multi-span houses, polytunnels or glass houses. Yeah. Within the houses, you can manage the environment using shade screens for helping to cool, fans that can either be used to bring cool air in from outside or expel hot air from the house outside, plus also fans inside the house to move air around and help reduce the relative humidity. Some of the fans are used to expel air, drawing air through water walls to get evaporative cooling effect in the house. And more common now seems to be using misting systems to get evaporative cooling in the house. Again, how the house handles that and gets that extra moisture out to manage the relative humidity is important. And things like ridge venting is very helpful there. There are certain things you can do with the coverings on glass houses and polytunnels now, as well as having plastics and glass that have certain UV qualities that suit plants. You can also get them where they block out certain wavelengths that insects use to identify plants. So you're effectively masking your crop from insects that might be blowing through towards them.
Is this used commercially now? Or?
Yeah, it is commercially available, both in plastics and in glass. Yeah.
So if anyone's had any experience with that, give us a yell out and you know, tell us what experience you've had with it.
Yeah.
So Andy, basically the insects can't see the crop. The wavelength, the reflected light is different to what they're usually looking for,
yes.
And they fly straight over the glass house.
It means that they won't actually target the glass house or target the crop. Of course, most of these insects aren't particularly strong flyers, so they're carried by the wind and such like. So you do need to protect against the what we call the blow-ins, and that. Where managing the screens, the vents and entrances to the glass house with screens is really important. Mm. Those screens can, you do sometimes have to compromise a little bit with those screens because the very fine mesh that will keep things like thrips out can actually reduce the airflow and make managing your glasshouse environment a little bit difficult, so you sometimes may have to compromise with a slightly wider mesh to allow better airflow, but just to help you keep the worst of the blow-ins out of the house.
So just going back to the plastic and that changing the light reflective nature of the crop, is that a widespread use already, or
in certain parts of the world? Yes, in Europe certainly, where glasshouse development is really sort of very high tech.
Yeah,
they're using this.
So if I got an old polytunnel that I'm going to reclad in plastic, can I go and buy something off the shelf?
You can actually, yeah, absolutely, and I have growers who are doing that actually, recladding. With these new polythenes here,
okay.
New plastic.
But once the insects are in your pests are inside the glass house, it's not going to have any.
No, impact. Unfortunately, once they're in, it's not going to slow them down. Yeah, yeah. One of the other things to think about, as well as venting, putting screens on the vents, is managing doors. Having an airlock where you have a two-door system is a very good way of trying to stop pests blowing in through easy access. Another thing to think about, just moving on, is the layout within the house and how that makes your pest management easier and more effective. Having the layout so that you can actually monitor all plants and not just some edges and some corners is really important. Also planning how you might, if you do have to go in to spray, how you're going to get access to the plants to get effective spraying. One of the big problems with resistance management is poor coverage, giving you ineffective control. Also managing the flooring is also important in insect management as well as disease management. Ideally, floors should be, concrete would be best to be able to manage weeds and such like. They need to be well draining. In a lot of circumstances where that's just too expensive, weed mat can be used across the floor to try and prevent weed development. And one of the things that I've been doing with some growers is putting plastic, drained plastic with holes in so it can drain underneath the weed mat, because there are certain pests like fungus gnats and shore flies that will breed up in wet soils, especially if there's overhead watering in the glasshouse and it's not just hydroponics. They'll breed up. They can breed up in large numbers in the soil under the weed mat, and then come up and infest the crop. But a plastic underneath the weed mat can actually help suppress those numbers. So that's quite useful. And then other practices are just general good management practices, which I'm sure everybody's heard discussed when looking at pest management.
Andy, I'll just pause you there. In terms of, you talked a bit about the infrastructure, the capital of a glasshouse. You know, just to put you on the spot, how important is that in terms of the whole integrated pest management approach? Like, how much gain can you get by thinking about how the structure of your glasshouse is going to impact on your pests?
I think it's become more and more important when dealing with critical pests like the ones we're talking about today. They are becoming more frequently resistant to insecticides. There are reducing numbers of insecticide options there, which used to be the easy way of managing them. And for certain pests like western flower thrips, there are populations of those that I've come across that seem to be resistant, 100% resistant to all the legal chemicals out there. And the growers that I'm working with, who have problems with them and the virus that they carry, are having to look at these options of how do they manage their crop to reduce the damage and the problems that they're having. They have no other options.
Mm. So I guess what's interesting about it is it you're taking the concept of IPM and broadening it a bit more than just sort of the classical introduce a predator type thing.
I think these have always been part of what pure IPM is, but IPM has often just been seen as rotating chemicals and maybe using a biological control if you can. Mm. Full IPM really takes into account all of these options and practices. Mm. And the state of the pests is forcing us more and more to go back and look at these good basic principles. I understand that they're all there are always financial constraints, obviously. But if you're forced to a position where you're actually having to throw out three quarters of a crop because you cannot control a pest or the diseases that pest is bringing in, then the finances start to make more sense, and you need to look at these other options.
Thanks for that, Andy. I'm just going to give you a little notice about a question. We've got a question coming about effective biocontrol agents for soft-scale pests in greenhouse. So I'll just give you a little bit of notice for when we get to the pests.
All right, I'll deal with that in a little while then. Yeah, certainly. good management practice. I'll just whip through these because these are things that everybody knows in discussions about glasshouse pest and disease management. Making sure that you start a crop with clean seedlings, with no pests or diseases on, whether they come from your own seedling nursery or whether they're bought in from elsewhere, is obviously critically important. Glasshouse hygiene, cleaning up always after harvesting or any crop operations really is very important, not just for managing diseases, but also preventing certain insects. If there are eggs or young stages of insects on leaves that are dropped on the floor, if they're not cleaned up rapidly, then they'll just emerge and move back up into the crop and keep causing it problems. Clearing out a crop at the end of a crop, decontaminating a glasshouse and the structure is also quite important. And probably one of the easiest ways of doing that, if you can have, if you have the time, you're not overlapping crops, is to actually spray down the house and then just close it up for a couple of days and cook the house. If you can get the temperatures in the house up over the 50 degrees mark, you'll be killing most of the insects and disease problems that might be hanging out in there. Clearing around the glasshouse is really important. It's one of those things that sometimes gets forgotten or overlooked by busy growers, but weeds close up to the glasshouse are magnets for these kind of problem pests. Excuse me. And they're a likely source of infestation into the crop from outside the house. So managing the weeds around the house is really important. And then there's a lot of talk,
I was just going to jump in there, Andy. You know, some people advocate putting on, diverse plantings to attract beneficials around glasshouses and headlands, that sort of thing. What's your thoughts on that?
There's been a fair bit of research looked at what might be plants that could attract beneficial insects in as opposed to pests. There's an awful lot of broad leaf plants that unfortunately will attract pests and may not attract the beneficials in the numbers or at the time that you particularly want them. There is some research out there that you can check on that suggests certain native plants, I think saltbush I think was one of them, that can be quite useful because pollen feeding parasitic wasps and nectar feeding parasitic wasps particularly like them, but they're not very attractive to some of the leaf feeding insect pests. But certainly keeping down any broadleaf weeds within a good few metres of the house is critically important.
Yeah. So if you're going to have vegetation around it, what are grasses?
Grasses, probably better. I've seen some people doing herbs like thyme actually, which are, again, don't seem to attract many leaf-feeding insect pests into them and such like, can be useful as well. Yeah. Finally, the biosecurity is a very big bit of a buzzword at the moment and talked about quite a lot. There have been several presentations and field days about it recently, and that talks about preventing insects and pests being brought into the farm from outside, and there's quite a lot of information out there about what biosecurity practices you can employ to do that. And I won't go into any more detail on that now. That brings us on to monitoring, which is probably the most critical thing you can do in pest management of any sort. Good monitoring is essential if you're going to be able to make informed and intelligent decisions about how you're going to manage pests and diseases in a crop or in a glasshouse or in the field even. And to do good monitoring, the first principle is you have to make sure that somebody has the responsibility and the time to do that monitoring. If you're a solo operator, if you're the boss and nobody else around you can do it, then you have to make sure that you make yourself get into the crop and do a sensible, systematic, and efficient regular monitoring of that crop. Otherwise, you're always reacting to a crisis situation when things have got out of hand and you're going to be struggling to manage most of these pests. ideally, if there's somebody on the in the staff who can be given that responsibility, that's the best way to do it, that they are given the time and the responsibility to monitor during the spring, summer, once a week, to record what they're finding and then to come back to make recommendations of what needs to be done. And they need to be encouraged to learn what they're looking for and learn more about the things that I'm talking about here. But they also do need to be given that time rather than being drawn away to help out with picking or training or something like that. They need to be given that time to do proper, efficient monitoring. That's my little lecture over. the monitoring will vary on every farm. There are quite a lot of...
Before we go on that, Andy, in terms of monitoring, you know, what's your main objective? What are you trying to do? You're trying to find out as early as possible, is this a problem that's emerging? Rather than waiting for it, my God, you know, my white flies, you know, it's like a cloud as you walk down the road.
Yep.
You're trying to pick it up when it's at very low
at
levels.
At the very early stage, yeah. And that's the only way you'll stay on top of these pests. Once any of these pests, especially the ones we're talking about today, get themselves established in a glasshouse crop, you're fighting a rearguard action in trying to manage them. You won't eradicate them, and more often than not, you can start counting down the days of the crop from when you've realised that there is a problem. So the monitoring is to get in there at the very early stage, and to make any of your pest control actions effective and longer lasting.
Yeah.
And as I was going to say, monitoring will vary from farm to farm, crop to crop, and season to season. And although there are quite a lot of bits of information online about how to monitor a crop or what records to keep and such like, every farm will develop its own system over time that suits them and suits their crop. Again, it's like I say, somebody needs to be given the time or make the time to develop that for it to be effective. Let's get on and talk about the basics of it, which I've sort of split up into this when, where, how, and what. So when to monitor. Certain seasons, certain pests have certain seasons, so understanding the pests is very important. We'll be talking a little bit more in detail about the three key pests that we've selected this week, for this talk, in a little while. But all pests have certain seasons that are influences and when you should be looking for them. The environment, certain environments favour particular pests. Spider mites, for example, like hot, dry conditions. So they may not be a problem early in the season, but after an early heat wave like we've been having in Sydney just recently, spider mites will definitely become a problem. And then as part of your monitoring, keeping history, knowing your crop, knowing your farm, knowing your area will help you anticipate certain problems. Here in the Sydney Basin, we always have a spring influx of certain pests, thrips being one of them. When harvesting starts in the broadacre out west over the mountains, we then get the October, November spring winds. Those pests disturbed in that harvest get picked up by the wind, blown over the mountains, and just dumped into the Sydney Basin, and we have an annual problem. Where refers to both the structure and the plants. Where to look within the glasshouse is quite important. Obvious places are around the doors or vents where insects might just blow in. Also, any possible weeds. If there are any weedy patches within the glasshouse, those would be the first places I would go to look to find any of these insects. They always seem to start up on weeds and then move into the crop. On the plants, again, it comes down to understanding your insect pest. Insects have preferences for different parts of the plant that they'll infest. Sometimes it'll be where they'll start, but then they'll spread throughout the whole plant. Other times you should go to certain parts of the plant to look for particular pests, and getting to understand where those are can make your monitoring much quicker and much more efficient. Mm. How to monitor? There's a variety of things you can do, variety of things that can help with monitoring. Traps are the classic ones. Yellow sticky traps are very useful for picking up early signs of thrips, whitefly activity in any crop. There are some lures, some pheromone lures that can be used for certain insect pests as well, and they can be used alongside the sticky traps so that you can pick up early activity from insects. Tapping sheets is something that I use quite a lot. Certain thrips prefer the flowers of plants. With a sheet of white paper, or if the crop's wet, a white lid of a plastic Tupperware box, if you just lightly tap the flowers over the sheet, you can dislodge thrips and get an early sign of
that. So what you're talking about, eggplants, tomatoes?
Eggplants,
cucumbers,
yeah. Capsicums especially, yeah. Good way of picking up thrips, western flower thrips in capsicums, is just to lightly tap the flowers over a white sheet. Physical inspection, the obvious thing is to have a hand lens. They are critically important. My eyesight isn't the most brilliant, but even anybody with 20/20 eyesight, if you turn over a leaf and look at a spot and think, is that a piece of vermiculite or is that a mite or something like that? A hand lens, a times 10 hand lens is very useful.
I'd be lucky to see the vermiculite.
Thirdly, there I've got staff involvement. Monitoring is really important, as well as having somebody who is particularly specialising and making it their job to do the monitoring. Getting staff to be involved is really helpful. Any staff who are harvesting or training a crop are going all the way through handling almost every plant. And if you can get them to be able to identify certain key pests, or just to identify where they think there might be something marking a plant or it looks slightly odd to them. If they mark those areas with a piece of coloured tape so that the person who's doing the informed monitoring can go back and check on those sites, it's a very good way of getting an early sign of pest activity in the crop, and you're covering a much wider area of the crop than a single person doing a quick monitoring weekly can do. Also, I think staff often enjoy being involved in a little bit more depth in the crop. What am I monitoring? We come down now to really being able to identify what you're seeing on the leaves. And there's a variety of resources that can be used to help with that. Being able to identify pests, beneficial insects, and those things that are little brown flies that are just nothing, and they're not a problem, they're not an issue, and nobody need panic. There's a variety of ute guides and ID cards with really good pictures of pests and beneficials. AHR have put out the phone app, Veg Pest ID, which again has a whole range of crops and a whole range of the pests and the beneficial insects that you'll find in those crops, again with really good pictures.
And where can you get that from?
You can get that from AHR. You can go on using your app supplier of choice.
Yeah.
You can download that. It's called Veg Pest ID. Or the AHR website, I should think, would obviously link you to it, I think, as well.
But your app store and
your app store, yes, yeah.
Veg Pest ID.
Veg Pest ID, yep. That was sponsored by HAL or HIA as they are now. The biological control agent suppliers all have very good information, obviously, about the insects with good pictures of the insect pests and the biological controls or beneficial insects that they supply that will manage those insect pests. And the Department of Primary Industry websites usually have sections that deal with insect pests and often have particular crop information sheets which will have pictures of insect pests and descriptions of the insect pests. And AusVeg, the AusVeg Growers website also has fact sheets and research project PDFs that you can look at that will help with all of this.
Well, the alternative is that you get someone in like yourself to identify it or other providers. Yep.
There are some, you know, there are some commercial.
It's a fairly specialist role.
Agronomists and consultants around. Yeah. So, moving on to the specifics of the three pests that we selected as our key glasshouse pests. The first we're going to talk about is whitefly.
Just before you do move on, I had a question there in terms of the timing, the when you monitor. Are there critical times? Obviously, it'll be pest-specific and crop-specific, but there are... Like a lot of monitoring, there are times when you really should be doing it more intensely because they are the ones that are going to set up your whole crop.
Yep.
Is that crop and pest specific, or can you have a general rule of thumb that says, you know, at a 2 weeks after planting, then you really should do a thorough inspection?
It can vary a little bit with particular pests, but... really, it's season environment are the thing. Spring, summer, autumn are your key pest activity times. Of course, in heated glasshouses, pests can be a problem all year round. Yeah. But again, your monitoring gives you a history of when your particular problems can kick in that you can follow on from.
So, okay, thanks.
Yeah. So, with whitefly, I'm going slow, aren't I? I need to speed up there. There are a variety of different species of whitefly. The most common one in glasshouses are the greenhouse whitefly, but more and more there's becoming a problem with silverleaf whitefly. And a relatively new problem is brassica whitefly, which could be a problem in glasshouses on anybody who's growing kale or some of the Asian veggies, brassica Asian veggies in glasshouses. I'm going to deal with each of these pests just in the where, when, how, what style. And then I'll go through fairly quickly and then we'll take any questions that anybody might have about them. With whitefly, the main problem is that they can be vectors for certain tospoviruses. They also produce a sticky substance called honeydew when they're feeding, and this can coat the plant and mark fruit in the plants. And it also develops a black mold called sooty mold, which can interfere with the plant's ability to photosynthesize and so stress the plant as well. Whitefly can be a problem all year round in heated houses, in vegetable crops. But the key times of issues, problems are in spring and the summer. With whitefly, you really need to start monitoring as soon as a crop is planted. Where to check for whitefly? As always, near the doors, near any vents or any weeds that you might see in the crop. Whitefly adults tend to gather at the top of plants and they cluster in the growing tips of plants. And then they fly down and lay their eggs on lower leaves, and the juveniles develop down on the lower leaves. Juveniles, I'll just go back to that previous things. If you look at that silverleaf whitefly on the left-hand side, lower left-hand side, around it are whitefly scale. They're juvenile whitefly, and you'll tend to find those on lower leaves in the crop. How to monitor for them? Yellow sticky traps are very effective for monitoring for whitefly. They're actually attracted to the yellow in the sticky traps. So place the sticky traps near the top of the plant. So if you're training something like a cucumber crop, The sticky traps need to be up top, near the top, and that's where the adults will fly onto them. If you're monitoring the crop, gently brushing the top of the crop, the growing tips, if there are white flies, you'll disturb them. They fly up in a little cloud of white flies. They're not very strong flies, so they tend to fly up and then just drop back down again. But that's a good way of seeing if there's anything in there. And then checking the underside of the leaves, making regular checks throughout the house of the underside of lower leaves for any signs of the white fly scale, the juvenile scale. And again, a hand lens is really useful for that. What we're monitoring for is the several species of whitefly, as I said before, and there are a variety of biological control options for whitefly, which we will list here.
And just before you go into the biological control, how quickly can a low-level whitefly population go from not of a worry to, you know, I'm in deep trouble?
For these three pests, you can go from low level to frighteningly difficult to manage very, very quickly. Most of the biologicals for these particular pests, you would be starting possibly to trickle in even before you've seen the pest, because trying to deal with them, once you've found them in there, you'll find a few signs of them. But in a large glass house, that obviously means that there's quite a lot around and what have you. So, that's why monitoring is critically important, that the sooner you find any signs of these, you can start reacting and managing them and get on top of it, because that's what makes them such dangerous pests. They do become a problem so quickly. Yeah. The Encarthia wasp is the most common whitefly biological control. They're a little parasitic wasp that lays its eggs into the scale of whitefly. On the right-hand side there, those two black scale are juvenile whitefly in this early stage of the whitefly. And they've had a wasp lay its eggs into them, and they turn black as the wasp develops inside the egg, eats out the egg, and then it hatches out and goes back into the crop looking for whitefly to lay its eggs into. They're supplied on cards of parasitized whitefly scale that you can see there hanging beside the eggplant fruit. They have certain temperature preferences. They don't handle very hot weather particularly well. And they don't seem to be quite as effective in low light, cooler times of the year. So there are other biological controls. There's a couple of parasitic wasps. I won't go into too much detail about these, because there is proper detail on the websites of the biological control suppliers.
And you'll provide that at the end.
And I'll supply that at the end. Those contact details are there.
But all these biologicals are commercially available that you're talking about?
Yeah, all of these are commercially available and are being used effectively in glasshouses now. So that helps. As well as the parasitic wasps, there's a newish biological control in the city of Chorus, which is a bug in the myriad family, a very effective control for whitefly, but it is perhaps the sort of thing that somebody more advanced, more experienced with biological control should look at. Again, there'll be more information, and they need to talk to the supplier for the City of Chorus Biological Services to be able to make that work well. And the predatory mite, Montarensis, although mainly seen as a thrips predator, also has been found to feed on whitefly scale. In the thrips area, we're looking at, again, a variety of thrips that can be a problem, but especially the ones that can carry wilt virus or tospo viruses, and that's western flower thrips and onion thrips. Identifying thrips can be very difficult, specifically identifying them. If you look at that microscope picture of western flower thrips, the way you tell western flower thrips is to look at the hairs, whether it has hairs on the front and the back of that segment behind its eyes, and then at the width of the gap between the hairs between its eyes. What I'm getting at here, what I'm getting at here is that people claim that they can tell the difference between different types of thrips just by looking at them with a hand lens. Quite honestly, you can't.
Andy, just a general question, like for the white fly, there were 3 or 4 species. The thrips are the same, and the mites.
Yeah.
How, like within any of those categories, how important it is for you to identify what species you've got? Does it change your control options?
Yes, it does. Yeah, good question. Sorry, I should have stressed that. Certain of these insects are particularly resistant to pesticides. Some of them won't be controlled by the most common biological controls. So it really is important that you ID the specific insect species that you're dealing with, and that way you can tailor your management to be effective without wasting time and effort, and in fact maybe not even getting control of it because you've been trying the wrong things. So it is really important to be able to do
that. So it's not just a nicety to know which species it is.
I'm afraid not. No. I mean, taxonomy is not my strong point, but learning how to identify these different ones is really critical. Yep. So yeah. And with the thrips, it's very much a similar line of approaching the monitoring, when to monitor, again all year round in heated houses, but mainly in the spring, summer and autumn can be a problem, and monitoring should start straight away. Where can they be a problem? Well, certain thrips are attracted to flowers, as Western flower thrips name suggests. Those you should be inspecting the flowers of the crop. They're particularly an issue in cucumbers, capsicums, eggplant. One of the quick ways of checking for those is tapping out those plants as I described over white sheets of paper. Mm-hmm. Yellow sticky traps, they are attracted to yellow sticky traps, but they've also been shown to be attracted to blue sticky traps. And there is also pheromone for Western flower thrips, which can be quite helpful for identifying them early. There are several species of thrips that we've just discussed, and IDing them is really important to make sure that you deal with them in the right way. There are a variety of biological controls for them, predatory mites and a predatory bug. Aureus is good in capsicums, very good in capsicums for thrips control, Western flower thrips control, but not so good in other crops. It needs the pollen that capsicum plants can produce to help it keep going and breeding. All of the biological controls information you can find from the suppliers with details about them. Spider mites, another one, an oldest of the critical pests. There are two key species of spider mite that are often a problem in glasshouse vegetables: the two-spotted mite and the bean spider mite. Their feeding damage can actually kill a plant, but also when they build up into large numbers, they produce this webbing, this spider-type webbing over the tops of plants, and again, this can kill the plant or just make the plant make the fruit unsalable. They're not specifically disease spreaders of viruses and such like. Monitoring for them, they prefer warm, dry or hot dry conditions, so spring and summer is main time. Two-spotted mite can actually hibernate in cooler weather with shorter days, and they can actually crawl off into the structures of a glass house or mulch or somewhere like that and hibernate over the cooler period, then come to life again in the warm. So monitoring should start as soon as spring crop is planted. Where to look for them? One of the places to especially check is along the westerly wall of a glasshouse, the hot wall. That's where often you'll find the first signs of spider mites getting active. And what to look for is the mites are on the underside of the leaves, and they feed by piercing the cells and sucking the sap out of the cells. And when they do that, they leave a little mottling effect, a clear cell that looks white on the green leaf, and you'll start to notice where mites are feeding, little patches of these little spots, white spots. How to find them is to turn over the leaves and inspect those areas with a hand lens looking for the mites. There are a couple of biological controls that are very effective against spider mites. Persimilis is the most commonly used one, is probably the most effective spider mite control. It does, however, suffer in very high temperatures, and Californicus, which is another predatory mite, can be quite useful then alongside it, which handles higher temperatures and lower humidities a little better.
So would you normally introduce those together?
Normally you'd start off with Persimilis, I would say. Depending on your crop, some of the strawberry crops actually prefer Californicus. But in vegetables, you'd normally manage with Persimilis. If you have if the environment in your glasshouse is well managed, Persimilis will keep going quite happily all through the year because you're managing temperatures and humidities. But if you do have some problems in keeping temperatures down in the glasshouse, they may not cope with high summer temperatures. Yeah. And really, this is just a wrap-up, and we're almost out of time.
Just going back to the biocontrol agent for the soft scaly pests, have you got any thoughts?
Biological service in soft scale in orchards can be an issue. There's a couple of native lady beetles that Bugs for Bugs in Queensland rears and supply to orchards. Whether they would work in a glass house or not, you would have to discuss with them. Some beneficial insects don't handle the glasshouse environment particularly well. Unfortunately, especially if they're flying insects, they can be introduced into the glasshouse, but their first instinct is to fly off to the light, and they take themselves up to the roof and they cook. I would discuss that with Bugs for Bugs in Queensland, and their email contact is or their website contact is on.
It does raise a general issue of like with biological control. What's the difference in using it in an IPM setting? What's the difference between glasshouse crops versus outside crops?
Well, it's really having the opportunity to manage the environment for them. Yeah. Where in a glasshouse crop, you actually can make the environment more suitable for the beneficial insect over the pest insect, whereas outside you're at the mercy of the weather.
So what you're saying is that there's more potential in a glasshouse environment.
Yeah, most of the biological controls have been developed for glasshouse crop usage. So, like I say, do you want me to just quickly bypass these?
Well, just going back to your soft scaly, I'm not quite sure. There was no detail in terms of what crop it was on. But there are probably fairly limited options, but just check on that.
With biological control, yes, but we would check with Bugs for Bugs because, as I say, the biological controls that are used on soft scale in orchards may not be suitable in a glasshouse situation.
Okay, as Andy starts to wrap up, so if you've got any other questions, please put them in now because we'll be looking to finish up in probably 5 to 10 minutes.
I've run on a bit, yeah. Sorry. When we got to a point now where we're discussing about what to do, if you've introduced biological controls and your monitoring is suggesting that they aren't able to stay on top of an insect problem, or if your pest problem has taken you by surprise and it's beyond being controlled with any of these other means, then pesticides should be your last resort choice of how to manage these insects. As we've talked before, they have very high resistance to many insecticides. Also, certain insecticides are going to cause you problems with your other biological control. If you're managing one of these other key pests well with biological control, you don't want to go in and ruin that while trying to spray out something else. That kind of information is out there. I might just skip ahead to this chart here. There are a variety of these charts that show the effects of commonly used insecticides on beneficial insects. They're rough guides, and there's quite a lot involved in making these kind of choices. The biological control companies will give you information about where you can get this kind of information and about their particular products. I might just go back to that previous screen. The idea of when you use an insecticide is that you must get good application, you must get good coverage. Resistance is such a problem with good, safe or softer chemicals. If they're not applied well, then you just encourage resistance within the insects. Rotation is an important part of resistance management, and Paul Horn has just recently given one of these webinars about insecticide resistance management, and I can highly recommend that to people who may not have seen it. And avoiding broad spectrum insecticides, they can lead to, any of the insecticides can lead to unplanned problems. The information, this I think we're going to make this available as links for information about the effects of pesticides and biological controls. In Europe, there are two large companies that have websites which deal with the side effects of chemicals on biological control agents. That's Coppertz and BioPest, and you can access those online. AusVeg and Protected Cropping Australia have good technical insights and tech notes about vegetable pest and disease management that can be very helpful as well.
So Andy, if you're just going into the or adopting or changing to an IPM approach, what's the sort of first steps that you should be thinking about taking? A lot of growers find it pretty scary to back off the reliance on insecticides.
Absolutely. I mean, a lot of growers sometimes find themselves in a position where they just can't manage a particular pest. And that's when you have to start looking at all these other alternative options. There are, like I say, populations now of Western flower thrips that appear to be resistant to all pesticides. For growers who have problems with influxes of Western flower thrips from properties around them, their only option is to work their way through all of these other management practices to try and reduce the impact of that particular pest.
Yeah.
Yeah. First steps are back to the practical physical side, cultural sides of things. Again, Paul Horn is going to be doing some more of these webinars. Early in the new year, he's going to be talking about the use of pesticides with biological controls and the side effects or the unexpected effects that some pesticides might have. That's going to be very useful for anyone who's using IPM. He's also going to be talking about training advisors and such like. He's got a project in South Australia working, I think, in Virginia with advisors to help them become more expert in their IPM advice for growers, so that the kind of specialist information or more technical information is available to growers more easily.
Yeah, because we can see through just your examples of identifying the right what yes. species you've actually got, and then what yep. course of action is practical.
Finding someone convenient who you can go to get that kind of help mm. is important and not always easy. Yeah. Don't know. Yes, that's just a mention of Paul Horn and Jessica Page from IPM Technologies, who are doing more of these webinars. Yes, their project, which is, I believe, an HIA project. So, there we are. Whipped through the end there. Sorry, went on a bit.
Well, thanks for that, Andy. That was a really good overview, and it was interesting to see you stressing the infrastructure or the actual glasshouse and the potential role that can play in managing those three pests and trying to reduce their impact on the crop and ultimately the profitability of the growers. So thanks to Andy for coming along and giving the seminar today. Like I said at the beginning, it'll be on our website, on the ICP Soil Wealth website in the next day or so, and you can send it around to your colleagues or view it again. I think our next webinar is on the 1st of December, and it's on biofumigation, so back into the soil, and we'll be looking at the role of biofumigant crops and the role that they can play in managing soil-borne diseases and soil health in general. And that'll be a webinar presented by Julie Finnegan from Survag in Tasmania. So thanks for your attendance at today's webinar. Cheerio.
Thank you.